Topic of the panel discussion is education, technology, and state. Let me first introduce all the panelists. Before that, welcome Dr. Sahana, Mr. Gurumurthy, and Dr. G. N., Dr. Amit. So, Sahana Murthy is a professor in the educational technology interdisciplinary program at IIT Bombay. Her research interest is in technology-enhanced learning of disciplinary practices, which includes developing students' problem solving, design thinking, and inquiry-enhanced learning environments. Another area of focus is teacher use of educational technologies, which has led to the design of models such as the learner-centric MOOC model, which has formed the basis for several online and blended courses on Swayam and IIT Bombay X platforms. More recently, she has been leading the EdTech Tulna initiative, a research practice partnership between various stakeholders to address the quality education of EdTech products in India. Before joining IIT Bombay, she was a postdoctoral researcher in physics education research at MIT USA and Rutgers University. She received her bachelor's degree from the University of Mumbai, master's degree in physics from IIT Bombay, and PhD in physics from Rutgers University. Our second panelist is Gurumurthy Kasinathan. He is one of the founders of IT for Change. He has 32 years of experience in the development and corporate sectors. He leads projects in the area of education, including in research, demonstration projects, systemic teacher education reform, and policy advocacy. His areas of expertise include ICT integration in school education, teacher education, and pre-service teacher education. He also works in the areas of school leadership and free and open digital technologies. He was earlier with Azim Premji Foundation, where he was deputed to work in the policy planning unit in the Karnataka Education Department. He has been a visiting faculty at TIS Mumbai and Hyderabad for their education leadership and management and ICT and education courses. Our third panelist is Professor Nagarjun. So he is a retired faculty. He's a former faculty member here at HBCSE. He was a former professor at HBCSE. He designs and develops educational technologies for learning and mentoring in a collaborative participatory environment such as Chatshala, in contrast with Pathshala. He's a principal investigator of the knowledge.org project, which designed and developed the infrastructure for NROER. NROER is a national repository for open educational resources, and also metastudio.org. His team contributed to the design and development of the platform for the Connected Learning Initiative in collaboration with TIS and MIT. He is an advocate of freedom to read, write, and whisper in the digital world. He does research in the area of history and philosophy of science and biological roots of knowledge. And this panel discussion will be moderated by Dr. Amit Dhakulkar. Dr. Amit is a postdoctoral research fellow within the UNESCO chair on multimodal learning and OER, which is open education resources, in Northwest University, South Africa, and has a PhD in science education from HBCSE. The primary area of Amit's work is in science and mathematics education. In his PhD thesis, he looked at aspects of graphicacy is pertaining to graphs, in the context of learning science and mathematics in school. He has also taught and developed several courses and modules in this area and have special interest in history and philosophy of science relevant for education. The broader interest of Amit's, the broader interest area that he has in the context of technology and OER is the use of technology in education and its political, pedagogical, and sociological aspects. He has advocated the use of free and open source software and OER at various levels and is currently doing research in the area of OER. So now I request Amit to take over and moderate the panel discussion. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Vikram, for this introduction. And it's great to connect with all of you again. And I have known the panelists for some years now, all three of them. And I have been enriched in my own work from inputs from all of them. So the themes for this panel discussions are not new. I mean, technology has been driver of educational change for a long time. But with the present state of computers, it makes an unprecedented connections to other aspects of our life as well. And technology is often disruptive in nature, as we have seen in various contexts. And we are, I think, on the brink of a major change in our educational system, or the change has already begun. We are yet to see the implications of it. So this panel discussion is trying to bring out these aspects of various aspects of technology and its implications to our teaching learning processes in general. And we'll look at some of the aspects in detail in some of the themes of this panel discussion. And with particularly with COVID-19, it acted like a catalyst for all these changes. I mean, so things we thought that would not be possible for next 5-10 years, and suddenly we're at our doorstep, because all the learning shifted to online mode in an overnight manner. Because all the schools and colleges were closed, and so we are imposed with this kind of change drastically. And this last 1.5 years has given a sort of palantir view of how the future might be with like only online learning or a large-scale implementation of it. So our panelists have worked in this area for a long time, and particularly in the Indian context, and would like to get their views on various aspects, and particularly noting the opportunities and challenges that are present in these themes. So way we have structured this panel discussion is that we have about 5 major themes that we'll be discussing, and we'll give about 15 minutes for each theme, and we'll take a break of about 5 minutes at the end of the hour, and then we'll continue again with 2 remaining things, and last 30 minutes have been kept for question and answers from the audience. So unless the audience has an urgent clarificatory type of question, the questions will be answered at the end of the session. Okay, so hope this is all right. And particularly, so first theme is the broader impact of technology in education. And this is particularly very important to the Global South, in which like infrastructure is not as good as it is supposed to be, or it is not in place at all. This is the larger theme for the first discussion, or first theme for the discussion is impact of technology in education. I mean, so what are the broader, what is the broad strokes which would paint this impact? While there is a lot of potential for a revolutionary change, quote unquote, but it has not been seen. So my question to the panelists is that what is actually possible in this context of technology in education, and what are the major challenges that we face in the Indian context? So perhaps we can start the discussion on this question, that what is possible and what are the major challenges of technology in education in Indian context? And then we can take forward the other responses. So, maybe Professor Sahana, you can start with this, and then we can take other opinions as well. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Amit. Thanks to the ARM organizers also for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to interact and to be back at HPCSC. So, regarding your question about what is possible, there is a lot of hype. We know all that. There's also a lot of potential benefit. There's also some vilification, so that the stage is very broad. But the way we think of it in our department, because our department is about 10 years old, it's called Educational Technology. It's situated within IIT Bombay. And there's a lot of focus. The primary focus is on learning via technology. So it's always in that order. So I would like to talk about 2 things here. One is that when we conceive of any technology enhanced learning project, we think of, you know, what exactly we are targeting. And sometimes this goes by the name of technology enhanced learning metrics. And we sort of have 4 broad categories. The first one, and these go in the order of easy to recognize, easy to measure, to something that's really challenging to recognize and challenging to measure. So the first one is efficiency. You know, technology, we all know that's sort of the easiest thing technology can do for us. It can speed up processes, it can save resources, it can, those kind of issues. So that is what a lot of things in general in the overall in the world technology is doing. This is something we don't focus too much in our department in terms of the R&D. The next thing is the accessibility, and this is sort of important. Accessibility can be in terms of scaling and numbers. again, that's something which is easy to identify and easy to measure. Or technology can help reach out newer geographical regions. Technology can help out reach out to different populations and so on. The third one is what is called attractiveness. And this bucket is about engagement of learners. Now, how much can we get them to spend more time on something that's meaningful through technology? And it's not just the jazz and, you know, the hype that comes with it, but there are certain things technology can do to engage. It could be motion graphics. That's sort of the most obvious thing, but it could also be things more richer and more meaningful for the content. So attractiveness is essentially learner engagement, getting them to pay more attention. And the last one actually has the name effectiveness, which is sort of a catch-all. That's about actual learning. You know, it's the hardest to measure, hardest to identify. So when we think of technology enhanced learning, it's very hard, and it's not at all a good idea to design for all four together. So the people who are doing research and development in this area, it's very important to have clarity on which one of these we are targeting. And one advice that I got a long time ago is that choose one as your primary and at most one as your secondary. Don't try to attempt all four, and that's what we tell our students also. So maybe we can go around the table. I do want to talk of one more new initiative that Vikram mentioned called EdTech Tulna, but maybe I'll come back after the other panelists have responded.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Professor Sahana, for that thing. Guru, would you want to pitch in for this question?
Yeah.
I can't hear Guru.
Yeah, it is very low actually. I mean, the volume is very low. If you could amp up it a bit, it might be useful.
Is it better now, Amit?
Yeah, definitely better than what? Yeah, it's better now.
Fine. I'm a little conscious because people have complained that my volume is very high, so, and that hurts people's ears, so I try to keep it low. If I'm audible now, I'll start. First of all, thank you so much, Tomi Baba Science Center, for having me on this panel, and I'm so looking forward to listening to Dr. Sahana, who I have not met, and equally to GN, who is an old friend and co-conspirator, if I may say so. I'm happy to be here with all of you, and sorry once again for not being able to turn my camera on due to some hardware glitch. In terms of larger potential and challenges, I would like to take one step back and say that the purpose of any technology is to make life better. I mean, that's a definition of technology. And education technology has to be situated within that. So an education technology, by and large, we usually talk of only computers or internet, but any technology, even a very simple thing like a duster in a classroom, has a very important role to play, because that's the only way the person teaching can keep writing again and again. And that's the purpose of the duster. So every technology's purpose is that it has to help and simplify and make the job of learning easier. When it comes to education technology, one of the challenges that we have is that it seems to be able to do so many things. So it seems to be able to enable content to come into the teaching learning processes much easier. We can go to the net, we can access materials, and that, you know, is an important element of teaching. It also seems to enable pedagogy to be much better by allowing teachers to bring in videos. And, you know, in the previous session, we were looking at astronomy, and of course, you can bring astronomy into the classroom using tools like Stellarium. So there is a lot that one can do in content and pedagogy. And that is what, you know, Dr. Punya Mishra has conceptualized as the technological, pedagogical content knowledge framework, which I invite all the people in the audience. If you're not heard of that framework, that's a very useful framework to look at how technology can be useful in teaching learning. It's called the TPCK framework, Technological Pedagogical Content Knowledge Framework. So that is if you look at the area of teaching learning per se. But when you say education is much more than teaching learning. And the problem that we have as far as technology is concerned is that the sector, and that's not only the edtech sector, the entire tech sector is very much driven by large corporations. And large corporations dictate what the discourse is, what we will understand as what technology can do. And obviously these large corporations are only primarily concerned with their commercial interests. So unfortunately, a lot of the hype that we hear comes from edtech corporations' desire to have more and more users, more and more consumers, more and more customers for that product. And that can take away from the possibilities that technology can actually be used. So then what can it be used for? I would like to say in a broader sense, technology has to help achieve the original goals of education. So what are the goals of education? Empower learners, empower teachers, decentralized power structures. So in India, for example, we have an extremely centralized bureaucratic hierarchical system. Can technology be used to actually empower teachers and learners? Can technology be used to empower disempowered bureaucrats? So disempowerment of bureaucrats is extremely important because that's how we can empower the grassroots. Can it help in decentralization? Can it help resist the privatization of education that we see happening? Actually, it's the contrary. You know, technology is helping privatization of education greatly, but we need to resist that. So I see that there are possibilities, but there are even bigger challenges and dangers that we need to be aware of. We need to wear educators hat. I think too often we are enamored by technology and we forget the basic principles of education, which is to empower learners and teachers. If we keep that in mind, then I think we will be guided in how we can go about using technology. This is what I would like to say as my initial comments. I'll come in later. Thank you, Amit.
Thanks, Guru, for that comment. Jian, would you like to pitch in this question?
So, you see, there are, the question is mostly posed as what is possible. And so if we can't answer this question without saying what was difficult earlier or what was impossible earlier, which has become possible now. one important consideration that we need to keep in mind is that this is the specific technology that we're talking about is in general media. We were already using media even before the technology came in, which could mean the books, the language, and whatever we are using inside the classroom, like the blackboard or the projector and things like that. So the specific change that happened is the nature of this media. And as a result, some important things are possible, cognitively. And as Amit mentioned, this particular media has a very disruptive role in the society. And for example, the need, for example, to have the old model of classrooms, the architectural plan of a school or a college and a classroom with one person speaking and the rest of the people listening, and the way how these structures actually have been put together is being challenged by this medium. And that is one most important change that we have to see within the structure of how the practice of education itself actually has to be done. Because now, for example, in the olden times, when as soon as the teacher comes, the first thing that the teacher requests everybody in the classroom is to remain silent. And now, if you really use this new technology, you really don't have to ask anybody to remain silent, because there are alternative ways in which people can continue to communicate with each other, whether it is related to what's happening in the class or otherwise. So this is a very interesting possibilities. Because and in many of the interventions that we invented or used in our own interventions actually used this particular model quite efficiently. The point is that it's possible to communicate. And why it's so important is because that's a contrast that I usually draw using the pun of Pathshala and Chatshala, is that if conversation is one of the core practices that makes education possible. And earlier, because of the media limitations, we were not able to encourage conversation in the classroom. But today, we not only are able to encourage conversation, whether it's in the classroom or outside the classroom, because the classroom doesn't have to be synchronous. That means the teacher and the students do not have to be at the same time. They can be distributed asynchronously and across the time. So this is a major possibility, which is very difficult to implement in the old technology. This particular feature itself alone has enormous ability to disrupt the existing things. But unfortunately, as you know, I think Sahana already mentioned this point about the access to this new media. So access to new media, particularly in Indian context, is, I can say, almost nothing, except in some of the expensive schools. A device accessed in every children's hand is impossible. Like, in the olden times, when we always said that, every student must have a notebook and a pencil or a pen or a slate in his hand to say that he's a learner. And if you really want to transform that into the current model, it is important to have this new slate, whether you call it a tablet or a netbook or a laptop or whatever it is. That kind of an access is a very important thing to talk about. And that is not there. And as a result, what we saw is an abuse of the education technology rather than the use of this education technology in the classrooms. For example, the most prominent abuse was what I sometimes call it as, PPT being used, because that is what you call it as a presentation device. And as you can see, this particular model is the convenience of the teacher, but not something that actually enhances pedagogy. We have no evidence that a PPT enhances learning, but still, it has been pushed into every classroom and every teacher training included, training them on a very teacher-oriented, administration-oriented technology instead of using child-centered technologies being used. So these are some of the problems that we see. Yeah. That is, without understanding the affordances of the new technology, if you start using them in the classroom, what are the new possibilities? What are the new affordances that the technology can actually give you? I think it will cause more harm than good in the education.
Thanks, Jen, for that input. So the related to what you said, actually, I would like to continue this conversation in relation to collective or peer learning that is possible in the realm of with the help of technology, because that is one area that earlier was not possible because communication between peers or community members was limited to physical access. But now we have technology with which you can communicate with people across the world. So what kind of future do you see in the collective or peer learning aspects of technology? Maybe Sahana, would you like to go first for this?
No, let Jian or Guru go ahead.
Okay.
For this one.
Yeah. Jian, please, would you add something to this line?
Yeah, you see, the peer learning happens when, as I mentioned earlier, when communication is possible. And as you can see now, one of the major themes of modern pedagogy is collaboration, trying to do things together, learn together. And also, I wanted to refer to the older architecture. The older architecture was to keep all the people of the same age in one class. And then you expect to have peer learning to happen. But some of the models actually suggest that it is very important to have a vertical kind of structuring of the classrooms in the sense of multiple age groups in a similar inquiry. You know, the engagement needs to have people with different learning abilities, and that actually offers when communication and collaboration is enforced or being part of the design, then a lot of communication happens between them. And this is one of the lessons that we learned, is to the advantage of, for example, having a school student interact with a college student, for example. I would call it as a very important context of peer learning, because there's a lot that college students learn while answering the questions of the school students, et cetera. And I mean, because, you know, and also it also disrupts, of course, the one-sided communication that used to happen from teacher to one-to-many kind of things, rather than, you know, many-to-many kind of conversations. And I want to add one more point before I stop talking about on this issue, is that the new technology actually allows you to have an archive of all the conversations that happen, of all the pictures or images or videos, etc., that are actually possible or shared across times. And this is actually a very important aspect even in peer learning. And people learn at different paces, and therefore this is a very important dimension that is added. And of course, peer-to-peer learning is very difficult in a regular classroom because it will be very, very noisy. And we can eliminate that noise and encourage peer learning in this modern technology because of alternate ways in which communication can happen.
Thanks, Jain. Guru, would you like to pitch in for this particular aspect?
Yeah. There are two points I want to make. I mean, Jain has spoken a lot, not so much today, about the way technology should be designed so that the communication is more decentralized and peer-to-peer. And I think he has several times also shown architectures of networks which will permit and encourage that kind of a peer and peer networking, rather than it being the conventional hub and spoke mode that we always think of when we think of technology. Traditionally, when we think of technology, we think hub and spoke. And that's why there is an Aadhaar database in Delhi and everybody has to submit their information to the single database. But we don't need to think of technology as only supporting centralization, which is the problem, but it can actually support the non-hierarchical or the peer networks. One thing I wanted to add to what GN said is, see, one of the problems with technology, and we know about it in the social media space even more than any other spaces, what we call as creation of echo chambers. Echo chambers is basically everybody is talking only to the people who agree with them, who believe in the same things that they believe in. And these echo chambers are greatly responsible for increasing stratification of society. We are in a paradoxical situation. I see new digital technologies actually enable better communication possibilities. Then society should be more coherent than it was before. But we actually see in front of our eyes that WhatsApp or all these social media platforms are greatly pushing for more and more stratification, more and more, you know, echo chambers of people. So my thought would be, how can we enable, and that is also visible in children who go to schools. So we have a very stratified school system in India. We have the elite government schools, the Kendriya Vidyalayas, the Navodaya Vidyalayas. We have the elite private schools, and we have schools across the entire social spectrum. How can we get children to talk to one another across these spectrums? How can, like for me, if you take my background as an upper caste, upper class, male, I grew up with particular perspectives in my schooling environment. There were very few Dalits, there were no Adivasis, there were very few people from other religions in the group that I was learning together with. How can technology break through these kind of social, cultural barriers that exist amongst people in society, and definitely amongst children and learners also? I think that kind of a learning will be very different from only cognitive learning that we focus on today. So I would look at technology as enabling reduction in the social stratification that is happening. I'm dreaming, because that's not what is happening, but this is what I would like to see happen.
thanks, Guru, for that thing. Sahana, please go ahead.
Yeah, Amit, I actually want to pick up the other question you had in this impact of technology in education, that how can we distinguish exaggeration from the actual substance?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'd also try to touch upon some of the points that Guru and Jian made. So, so we all know that this is actually a big problem, that if we talk of technology and edtech, one of the key issues is that there is inadequate and varying understanding of what constitutes quality in educational technology. I'm sure this is true in other technologies also. I'll focus on edtech now. And when people say good, often we see these corporations, like Guru earlier mentioned, you know, they are the ones who are driving the adoption. We know that is an issue. There are lack of standards for quality, both in terms of evaluation, which means it leads to ad hoc decision making, either by parents or schools or by state governments, which do large scale adoption. The lack of standards, especially in the Indian context, also lead to the design of products, you know, with poor deliberation, with inconsistent logic, without sufficient attention to learners and teachers. Right, so these challenges are some things that have existed. We are all fairly familiar. And there's this big edtech ecosystem, which have researchers saying that, look, this is what is good design. Then we have governments having their own set of standards. Then we have the companies, we have the decision makers and so on. So about a year and a half ago, there was a new initiative. I've been part of a new initiative called EdTech Tulna. If I may just present my screen for, would that be okay, Amit?
Please go ahead. Yeah.
So this is actually a RPP, a research practice partnership. I would actually say RPPP, research practice policy partnership between IIT Bombay. So a group of faculty and students and some staff members, also a couple of PhD students from our department, we are involved. And Central Square Foundation is an NGO which is involved, and state governments are involved. I apologize for the noise, by the way. I live in this campus with lots of wildlife, both inside and outside. So if audio is a problem, just let me know. So it's a partnership, and the idea is to first establish quality standards, then to evaluate actual products, actual edtech products, and to empower the decision makers. So the philosophy that we came up with is that, look, we need standards to which are trusted by all these stakeholders in the ecosystem. We have to encourage demand of high quality by the decision makers, both individual and government decision makers, because governments, what happens is, Jian, you brought up this issue of access, right? State governments are putting out RFPs for example, the most recently that I've been involved with, Haryana government is planning to give out devices to some 5,000 government schools, but they don't know what content to put in it. And that's where the whole problem starts. People may have devices, but it's not being used effectively like what we are all saying. We also need to seek buy-in from the product supplies itself to generate high-quality products. So what this project is aiming to do is one of the things, the first thing that our group is doing is to design standards. And we've come up with three different constructs: content quality, pedagogical alignment, and technology and design. So each of these, for example, if we look at what is in it, it has different sub-constructs or criteria. And these standards now, there are different granularities at which we've written this. This is at a high level, which can be used by anybody who's doing procurement. It's also, we have a set of very detailed rubrics internally where our evaluation team is getting product companies to sign on to be evaluated. And we come up with a report which is going to be put up in a public portal. So the reason I'm just going to stop sharing. The reason I wanted to just bring this up is that there's beginning to be efforts. And some of the state governments have agreed to use such standards in their procurement processes. Some product companies, right now we have about 10 odd product companies on board saying that, yeah, we will let you evaluate our product design and put up the evaluation report in public. So the evaluation reports, these will be launched in about 2 months' time or so. So at least what we hope is that there'll be more of a conversation between all these players in the educational and educational technology ecosystem to try to go towards some understanding of quality and try to meet those standards.
Yeah, thank you, Sahana, for showing us that new project that you're working on. So two of the take-home points for this particular theme that, I would like to sort of summarize or bring forth. One is that you just showed us that there has to be some standardization in terms of the quality of the content, because as Jian also mentioned that just presenting PowerPoint slides is not actually using the technology to its fullest extent, or it's like rather abuse of it. So this is a very important idea to standardize or to create a framework in which the EdTech products can be evaluated. And the other aspect that both Jian and Guru touched upon is a possibility of peer learning or collective learning, in which age is not a bar or geographical location is not a bar. And that, I think, is actually a way of implementing the idea of zone of proximal development at a very large scale, because you will have learners at different potentials and a lot of vertical learning can happen in that regard. So with this note, I think we can move on to our next theme of discussion, Amit, which is, would you like to add something?
One very short response to what Sahana said. See, I think content is not something which has a standalone, particularly I'm talking about school education. Content is not outside of the teaching process that somebody will make some good quality content and then we provide it to the teachers. I think that's a very problematic perspective on education itself. If we have our perspective on content cannot be a commercial provider, whatever be the so-called quality of that content, we have to necessarily think of content as a participatory teacher-created process. Within that, quality standards have to come. There has to be curation, and that curation is best done by teachers' communities. So I think the more we keep EdTech vendors out of the whole education technology space, there is some dim chance that technology can be useful. The minute commercial interests are allowed to come in, it will be the death knell of education. I think I've absolutely, after all, 15 years of working in this space, I've absolutely no doubt in my mind that commercial considerations, proprietary considerations in terms of content production and content supply is very much the wrong direction to take. But quality, benchmarks, frameworks, all that is important. The process of engaging with one another on content issues is what will make teachers' communities of learning flourish. So we need to think of content from that point of view as a byproduct of teachers' conversations with one another and with students, rather than as some externally mediated artifact. Yeah, thank you.
Amit, can I just add one point to that? They're responding to
you. Yeah, please.
Yeah, yeah. So Guru, I completely agree with you, and especially that education is a public good. I think we all are on, we all have that stand. At the same time, if you take technology in any other sector, there is a coexistence between the public good, between what private players do, between, so there is a coexistence, and I don't think we can wish it away. The next best thing we can do is to see how the coexistence can be healthy towards the goal of, strong learning, strong teaching. Teachers must be a part of it. So part of the standards that we are developing how can teachers be empowered? How can they play a role? It can start with, what sort of support can be there? It can bring them more central into it. So I don't think we are sort of saying that, look, we are only looking at the private players, but I don't think that private players can entirely be sort of, waved away in this whole conversation.
I think some aspects of this we'll also cover in the copyleft theme of our discussion, because there is a growing consensus that all educational material should be in the open space or openly licensed. And that is where, even if it is produced by commercial interest, but if it is openly licensed, we can still make some progress in that regard. We'll come back to that in the next theme, next theme in our discussion. So let us now switch to the second theme of today, which is teacher education. So as all of you have been working with teachers in some aspects, so teachers are very crucial to like whatever policies or whatever plans we have to get implemented at the grassroots level. And the quality of any education system cannot go beyond the quality of its teachers. I mean, that's like the bottleneck that we have been facing for so long. In this, I would like to ask you, I mean, how has the teacher education been impacted by use of technology? And how do we prepare our teachers for such technocentric, quote-unquote, system of education in which like you use technology also not only for, let's say, the classroom management, but also to teach subject matter per se. So I would like some insights into this. Who would like to go first?
Can I?
Yeah, please, Guru.
So I think that, you know, I've had this whole debate in my own mind as to how does the teacher and the technology, how do these two relate to each other? And always the danger that exists that digital technologies particularly can be used to disempower teachers. I mentioned it in my initial remarks also. So I would think that the way we have to visualize digital technology is how can it empower the teacher? And then everything we design about technology should answer only that one question. Even this new thing that we are calling as personalized learning and artificial intelligence, even when we are exploring those issues, we need to really think, can I use artificial intelligence? Can I use big data? Can I use machine learning algorithms in way that the teacher is empowered? And the reason I'm saying is that I'm particularly focusing on school education. I'm not an expert at all in higher education, so I will not comment on that. But having worked for a long period in school education, I can say that the teacher-child relationship is the most important part of teaching learning, because teaching learning in school education is not simply about imbibing some complex content and then being able to regurgitate it in the exam. It is really conceptual understanding. That conceptual understanding requires a good, healthy relationship between the teacher and the learners. And it need not be, again, hub and spoke. It has to be a collaborative classroom environment. And to the extent digital technologies can be used by the teacher completely in a free and open manner. So it should be open resources, like you mentioned, in terms of content. It has to be free software in the terms of the digital tools that are used, because only these will provide empowerment to the teacher. If it's proprietary content or proprietary software, both will not allow the teacher full freedom in deciding how exactly to frame a lesson, how exactly to frame a conversation between the teacher and the learner. If we are able to stick to these two principles, that it has to be free and open and it has to empower, then we can find that the teacher will explore and experiment and figure out ways of reaching out to learners, because there is no one answer. What will work in Bidar will not work in Bangalore, and what will work in Bangalore will not work in Bombay. So we cannot think that there will be some standard ways by which technology can support teacher empowerment. Of course, we need to build the teacher's abilities to not only use technology. A lot of the conversation that we have is seeing the teacher as a user of technology and tech savvy. So the tech savvy means teacher can use applications. But I think the real challenge and what we need to do, apart from building teachers' ability to use applications, teachers' critical perspective on technology is extremely important, and we can do that in our own work in IT for Change. We always focus on critical perspective on technology along with the use of technology, because that is what will really help a teacher understand that technology can help her, technology can harm her. Once these basic principles are clear, I think there are enough number of opportunities in the digital world for the teacher to explore, experience, and then use them for the teaching learning processes. I'll give a slightly broad answer, but I think I would like to stay at that level.
Okay, thanks, Guru. Jin, would you like to go ahead next?
See, this is a very complex subject for a lot of reasons. As I said, first of all, that you see, teacher-student is a traditional concept. And now, after intervening with the modern media, of course, it's not going to be there anytime soon in India. But then one most important thing that's going to happen is that education will happen in a space of a community of practice. When I'm using the community of practice in a wider sense, that it doesn't just include only the teacher. It includes the teachers, it includes the fellow students, it includes the parents, it includes the brothers and sisters, it includes the society at large. Because that is the affordance of this new technology that offers, that it's possible for you to make the boundaries of the school porous, so to speak. And that is one of the important things. And therefore, I mean, I do think that you need an agency. I don't want to call that agent a teacher, because, you know, teacher has that traditional connotation. I would better use some kind of a catalyst for enabling engagement, promoting learning. And I mean, I'm just using these terms a little carefully. So because, you know, engagement is crucial. Now, what are the ways in which the engagement can happen? And I know, how do you seek the attention of the people around? And also to make sure that why is that the other people have attention and engagement elsewhere. And so it is to understand that all students do not need the same thing. But I mean, when we have been talking about diversity, you know, celebrating diversity is an important thing. And we also have to celebrate epistemic diversity. Different people have different skills and different appreciations have to be done. So, you know, the moment we talk about in the traditional teacher education models, you know, we are only talking about how do you support the educational infrastructure. So teacher is shown as someone who is going to support the educational infrastructure. That means who is going to sustain the existing infrastructure. He is supposed to complete the curriculum, complete the syllabus, you know, deliver the content and give them the grades, you know, graduate them, you know, assess them. You know, this is the way how we have been traditionally talking about this whole thing. And I have a feeling that all this is going to take time as the new media is going to disrupt this whole space. And then it might also involve new definitions, new models of how schools, colleges, and you know, all these things actually have to come about. Certainly think that, some agent will have to be authentic and given more power to provide this you know, very important education. But I am a little doubtful that, you know, if you only empower the teacher, then I have this problem in my mind. I mean, I'm just responding to also Guru to look at it a little more critically, saying that it might actually lead to sustaining an existing, I mean, you're also sustaining the problems that we are facing with as well, to continue to keep up the same way. And so I have a lot of doubts on just making teacher as more powerful. And I would think that the learner should become, learning should become more and more authentic. And for that, I really don't know what it takes, who is required to do this. I would just say that we have to catalyze that process. The whole system should be catalyzing the learning and not necessarily, because the learning doesn't happen unless an engagement is there. So I want to look for an engager and not a teacher. I just want to use a different word just for the sake of making it a critical.
Okay, thanks, Jen, for that input. Sahana, please go ahead.
Yeah, Jen, so thanks for bringing up this point about, you know, technology sort of amplifying certain problems that we see all the time. And rather than changing it, forget the drastic change, but it's actually amplifying the detrimental parts of some traditional aspects of the education. So in we saw this a lot in the last 1 year, right? In COVID time, suddenly everybody en masse had to become skillful at using as in just the usage of the tools, We are not talking of using the affordances more strongly, more powerfully. We are not talking of bringing learners on board. We are not talking of equality and justice and all. It just sort of became that. So we heard a lot of stories there. So I just want to share a case with you that came from one of the interviews of one of my students, one of my PhD students who's working with government school teachers in Kerala. And then, I don't have answers, but I want to share the case and pose a question at the end. So what my student is trying to do is to try to study in what way teachers are using these technologies now that we're sort of on the edge of moving past COVID. It's still there, but it isn't a crisis. It's at least perceptions are not that it's a crisis like it was, say, a year and 3 months ago. So he has been doing long interviews. And in one of the interviews, there was a teacher. She's around in her mid-20s. And what she said is that, look, I'm kind of halfway okay in using tools because I have a mobile and all that. But I'm not very comfortable. And what I started doing, what I found is that my students are a lot more, she teaches fifth and sixth and seventh grade. They're a lot more adept at using these technologies. So in one of the classes, there was a lot of chatter, there was some disruption. So I just paused and asked them, can you tell me how to use that? And that sort of changed the discourse in her classroom. And this was, at that point, it was an online class. I mean, like it is even today. So I think this narrative is from something like February of this year or so, or maybe even a month ago. I don't exactly remember which interview this is. So once she did that, her students started teaching her how to use the technology much better, where they could participate in the discussion. It soon turned to the learning. So the conversations flowed from how to use the technology to the actual content that they were discussing. And the learners, the students, students became co-creators of the knowledge of the content that they were discussing. So when the teacher was reflecting on all this, she said that, look, technology made me relax a lot more. In a classroom, I'm supposed to be the authority. I'm supposed to know everything. I can't tell the students that, look, I don't know how to do this and I can't let them speak as much. But because we were online and because, it's something new, I was initially not very comfortable, but I was okay asking them for help. But now I realize that, look, we are all in the same thing. So this was actually a very interesting case for us, because this is sort of what we want the teaching learning situation to be. And this was one case where we saw that technology was an enabler of bringing about, dismantling the hierarchies that we traditionally see between the teachers and the learners. What we don't know and we're trying to ponder is, how can we foster this sort of a usage of technology rather than perpetuating the more traditional hierarchical systems?
Thanks, Sahana, for that sharing that episode. So, one of the things that is coming forth is the open educational practices, which are possible only with open educational resources. And in that regard, there is some interesting work being done across the world to dismantle these hierarchies that you mentioned. And Gian also mentioned that, it's the traditional system of teacher versus student in a classroom space that actually creates a lot of problems. So there are efforts which use open educational resources and the freedoms that come with them to remix or to reuse or to recreate the learning material that is there. So in this regard, I'll just like to mention the idea of what is called as a renewable assessment or renewable assignment. So traditionally, any assignment that you are giving to students is usually thrown out after it is assessed. You'll have question papers which are written by students, and then after they're evaluated, they're just thrown out. So this idea of renewable assessments actually make sure that it contributes something back to the real world. And that, I think, has a good potential to engage both teachers as well as learners in this regard. And it also blurs the boundaries between, who is a teacher and who is a learner in that sense. So thanks for these inputs. We can either take a 5-minute break right now, or we'll take a break maybe after the next session. So I think some of the questions that are in the other themes are already being sort of preempted in some of these discussions. Particularly, all of you have touched upon the idea of access, that access is essential. So I think we can subsume that theme under the other questions that we'll be answering. So next, should we take a 5-minute break and we'll connect back again in 5 minutes and then we continue with this discussion? Is that okay? Hello?
I'm okay.
Either way is fine. You want to continue or you want to take a break.
So we'll take a 5 minutes break and right now it is 12:01. So maybe we can connect back at around 12:05 and then we'll continue with this discussion to the end.
Yeah, one small request while everybody's on the break. If Ravi's on this call, he posted a point on the chat. If he wants to just talk about it, if he's free in the break, if he doesn't mind missing his break, can he share his thoughts? I would like to listen to him.
Hi, Guru. It's Ravi here.
Yes, Ravi.
I mean, I kind of agree with you. I think there's work to be done in terms of evolving regulations, etc. I don't know much about that, so that's why I asked the question. And in the interest of people taking their break, maybe I'll come back and put other things which I had for GN in the chat after the break. Okay.
Thanks.
Hello everyone, welcome back. I hope all of you are still here. So we'll begin the next theme of our discussion, and which is regarding copyleft and open educational resources. So over the last decade and a half, let's say starting from launch of MIT's open courseware in around 2006, open educational resources have been increasing in quality and as well as quantity from across the world. And particularly for Global South, they actually present a very good opportunity to level the playing field in a way, because the access is sort of provided to all people who have access to devices. I mean, that being the catch there. This allows for a completely different approach to creation and dissemination of learning resources. Its impact has been throughout last decade. I mean, it has been felt very prominently, because let's say Wikipedia is a form of open educational resource which would not have been possible earlier because of the copyright restrictions. So one of the major overarching questions that I want to ask is that, what is the impact of copyleft movement in terms of open educational resources or open educational practices and free and open source software will have in the coming decade or so? We already have some impact of it, but let's see what the future holds for us. And what are the major challenges in this, in the Indian context? And also related questions are about privacy and freedom, which Guru has already touched upon several times earlier. And so how do we sort of reconcile with the rise of technology in all aspects of our life? And what sort of implications are there for democratization of education? So let us begin this session. Guru, would you like to go ahead first?
I've spoken a lot on this, so maybe I'll come in last.
Okay, sure. Jian, perhaps you can add.
Okay. Let me see. The issue is, there are multiple issues out here. You know, copyleft being one of the methods of granting freedom, to make sure that the resources are accessible to everyone. And the lot of changes have happened, because of this particular character. I also want to take the opportunity to also respond to one of the question which asked by KS in the chat about how professions are changing. I, for example, see a very important example. So, as you know, that about 10 years after copyleft became popular, that is the general public license, that was 1984. And after 10, about 10, 15 years, we saw that that has now been extended from software. It's being used in software initially to knowledge, that is the documents that we create. So which essentially would mean that the various technical documents, textbooks, and most importantly, the encyclopedia, the Wikipedia, being rewritten. Now, most important question that we have to ask is this particular question. So who wrote Wikipedia? So how many teachers wrote Wikipedia? How many professors wrote Wikipedia? When the media is accessible to the public, and there is a public space where people can negotiate with what is right, what is wrong, and how to make it, and there is a wonderful historical technology being used to document what happened at what time, who did what at what time, and that is an important affordance. And that has actually transformed the profession, the traditional professions. Because earlier, Britannica Encyclopedia, for example, was written mostly by university professors or the people who are known to be the technically expert people. But today, I don't think that is happening. In fact, there is a bank manager who writes about natural history because he happened to be a bank manager, but his interest and his heart is in natural history. So he continues to write excellent Wikipedia pages on natural history, but while his profession is something else. And there are engineers who write about design and art, and there are poets who are interested in science and things like that. So, and this is what I'm actually trying to say, that we have to, there is a lot of possibilities of restructuring that happens. And so that is one of the important potentials that we see when making knowledge. Everybody has the freedom to make knowledge. Everybody has freedom to repair what is already made. Everybody has freedom to correct what is already written. Everybody has freedom to recreate the resources and also share the resources and also grant the same freedom to everybody else. And that is the essence of copyleft. And copyleft has done this magic to this whole world. And of course, the whole idea of creating open educational resources is based on the premise of giving access to all. Access to all doesn't only mean that somebody is producing and it is granted to other people, that making everybody a producer. And that is the key point here. And when everybody is a producer, and when students are writing some document which the teacher is referring to, and that kind of instances also are known today, though not very well documented, but a lot of research is going on in those areas. And most importantly, for example, most of the software that is available today on GitLab and GitHub and all these places is actually being used by university professors, and most of it is actually written by the students. And sometimes some of them are not even formal students. So that is where I see that there's a changing relationship. The new professions are being made and unmade, and that's going to happen. And this is not possible without a disruptive copyleft idea or disruptive licensing model, whether it is public domain or copyleft or MIT license or whatever license that is there. It is the inviting everybody to be a producer is going to have a very, very different impact. And that is one of the reasons why I think that the traditional professions are likely to change.
Thanks, Jen. Sahana, would you like to say something about this?
Sure. So actually, it's more of a couple of questions for the other experts on the panel, because I'm not such an expert. But you are asked about challenges, Amit, right? Especially in the Indian context. So the way Jen has talked about copyleft, it's in a very broad sense where everybody is a producer. But Amit, you also talked about, things like MIT OCW or other resources which are accessible to everybody in terms of a user. We can go and consume it, but we are not producers of it. So, and that's sort of the more common way of thinking about OERs today, at least in our country. People are more, they're more likely to go and use something for their, if they are teachers or if they're learners, rather than produce it. Of course, we do have the producers, but as a teacher, how often or how comfortable, let's say, how often would you assign your students to go and use something in Wikipedia versus MIT OCW? But there is some sort of a difference today we still maintain in these two. So given this, one of the challenges is, how do I know as a common person which ones to select? How it's again the issue of, not one is the issue of quality, of course, but also of the issue of what is a better fit for me. And the second question, maybe related, is that of contextualization, that traditionally a lot of the content production has been done by people who are in the elite groups, for could be the colonizers versus the colonized, it could be the elite institutions versus the more people who are more who are not in such places, and so on. So there has been a hierarchy here. So now, if I say that, look, it's good. I know it's good and I want to use it, but it's not suitable. I need to contextualize it for my own group, my own students. What can be done? What sort of support can be given for such contextualization? I just want to, you know, pose these two questions as challenges.
Yeah, thanks for that. So actually, the quality aspect is one of the major concern for use of OERs. I mean, there has been substantial research in this area that, teachers or educators do not trust quality of the resources which have been created by other educators and which have been released as OER. And there is some truth to it also, because many of the OERs released don't have a quality, are not polished as, let's say, compared to a proprietary resource that is released. Other aspect is about the indigenous knowledge system. So, that's something, that's a dimension that is usually forgotten in the traditional educational system, that indigenous knowledge systems do not have a presence as such. And finally, the point that you also touched out of the contextualization, that, for example, it's not only the translation to local languages, but also examples which are relevant to the learners in their context that are required. Guru, perhaps you could pitch in for these two questions that Sahana.
Yeah, I think we can look at it in two ways. One is a pedagogical perspective and one is an economic perspective. If you look at it from this whole idea of content from a pedagogical perspective, I think we have to agree that quality is not an absolute construct at all. And I think this is, sometimes we lose sight of it, especially in the case of content, and we think this is quality content and that is not quality content. I don't think there is anything like that, because absolutely it is contextual. So when you are talking about even indigenous knowledge, or you're talking about different conditions of learners and different conditions of learning, the issue is not whether a content is quality or not. And therefore, this idea of proprietary good content versus bad OER content, I think, to my mind, that debate is not a very useful debate. We should ask ourselves, are we preparing every teacher to be able to pick up all the content that is, not all, pick up the content that's available and then customize it for what she wants? We already talked about contextualization. All content has to be contextualized for it to be. I have taught in classrooms and I know that every time I go to a classroom, I'm contextualizing it for that particular group of children I'm going to be working with. So there is no absolute content that I simply keep using again and again. Once you accept that the teacher's abilities are to be built, to be able to curate, to be able to access, to be able to modify, to be able to revise, to be able to contextualize, to be able to change the language of, to acculturize, if you are accepting that the goal of education has to be teacher empowerment, to use the content that is available and also shape it for the use that she wants to put to, then quality of content is a irrelevant concept. I'm just purposely pushing it to an extreme to say that that's not a debate. The debate is, can we empower our teachers? So that's a pedagogical perspective. The economic perspective is that the minute we get into a situation where we have non-copyleft content or we have proprietary content, then we see very typically the nexus of the bureaucrat and the corporation. And we see it everywhere. It's very much so in the digital space also, that there is a nexus, but the bureaucrat is captured by the corporations to push their own agenda. And that can only harm the cause of education. So, but that means we have an economic challenge, which is, how do you incentivize production? The argument is that proprietary models incentivize production by giving a return to the producer. Open models do not incentivize the producer. I don't know whether this argument is very true, because as I said earlier, if content is seen as a byproduct of teachers' conversations, teachers and teacher educators, teachers and students' conversations, then the economic model is not so crucial. But it is possible that we need to look at new policy environments by which we are able to incentivize even collaborative copyleft creation of content. It may be possible to look at it. For example, in the medicine space, I know that people are looking at pharmacy R&D to go on open models, and those models are to be explored. The idea of cooperatives is an old idea in the production space. Corporations is one method of production, cooperatives are another, and in areas like milk production or many other areas, cooperatives have been successful. Maybe in the whole area of digital content, we need to look at cooperatives and how we can incentivize cooperatives. The other way of looking at cooperatives in the space may be simply communities of practice, communities of learning. And those models are what policy needs to push rather than proprietary models under the guise of quality.
Thanks, Guru, for that insight. Jian, would you like to answer this question?
I'm enthusiastically waiting for an opportunity to participate in this dialogue because, see, this is the crux of the matter. You know, what is it that we want to have quality of? Like Sahana asked this question about do teachers know what is, or the students know what to select and what not to select. Now, my question is, how do you achieve that ability if you are not a producer yourself? In fact, all the people who judge content for others are actually the people who are producing or writing content for others. Now, if you don't want teachers to do that, but if you only want them to consume the content that you know, experts like us, right? Then we are actually not solving the problem. We're actually creating a problem. So I would like to look and shift the quality aspect from content to culture. So let us ask this question of how do we evaluate the cultural aspects of knowledge production and knowledge dissemination and engaging with various artifacts of knowledge. And if we talk about assessing the content, we are in a wrong place. It is better that we talk about, for example, something like, okay, what is the evidence that this particular proposition that is written in the text is actually correct? Now, can we talk about the processes of validating knowledge as the syllabus of education rather than accepting what is written by experts as accurate? So essentially what I'm talking about is processes of knowledge dynamics should be the place, and that is what we need to standardize, and that is what we need to agree upon and negotiate and work with, rather than talk about content being good quality content and bad quality content. We have to talk about best practices and worst practices rather than good quality content and bad quality content. And in fact, it has been a problem with scholasticism, history of humanism, the rise of humanism and all that, have questioned exactly that. And then gave power to the abilities of every human being to learn. And that is part of our universal human rights today, that we want to accept every human being as a capacity to learn, which essentially means that they also are able to construct knowledge on their own. They're also able to construct knowledge essentially also means that they're also able to judge knowledge on their own. So that is the reason why I want to play this political role and say that let us shift our focus from content to culture.
Thanks, Jian, for that. So one of the questions that perhaps we can also ask is because I want to look at the future, let's say in coming 10 years. So the essential characteristic is also about contextualization, as Sahana pointed. And contextualization inherently also presupposes decentralization of certain aspects, because without decentralization, you cannot do contextualization. For example, let's take textbooks that are used in the schools. Now, textbooks are produced centrally by some agency, and it may be relevant for certain section of population, but for other sections, it is not relevant at all. That aspect, one can definitely work through with the OERs, for example. So that aspect can be reworked, the textbooks can be reworked. But the agency has to be there, as Guru also pointed out, that agency to change things, agency to do things in a certain manner, which does not require a bureaucratic intervention at a higher level. So that empowerment has to come with Because without that, I mean, even having OERs is not going to change much on the ground level. So thanks for this. Sahana, I hope that your questions have been answered by Jian and Guru. So let us, or would you like to add any add-on question to what?
No, let's go ahead. Let's go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. So the next theme is about machine learning and AI. And so I would like to put it in as an algorithmic kind of approach to our living, because behind this, there are certain algorithms which run and which make the decision for you. And in many cases, these algorithms are not known. I mean, they're like black boxes. You put something in and you get something output, and it's justified because it's done by an algorithm or by a computer. And one of the this is going to have an impact on how we teach and learn, or how the transaction in the classroom or in the any learning spaces happens. Of course, I mean, there are certain aspects of which might be beneficial, like personalized learning, as it is called, which is one of the hype words. And other aspects are also about pertaining to certain, curiosities of the learner. So these can be made or used to justify their existence. But there are some concerns also that, like, if it is all driven by algorithms, then, I mean, what are the potential pitfalls in this approach? So the larger question that I would like to ask the panel is that, how will these technologies impact education in the next decade, and what are the challenges, and particularly in reference to ethics and biases of AI, or the algorithms rather. I mean, AI and machine learning are just two terms, but the basic idea is that they are all algorithm based, and the algorithms are written by some people and who have their own biases or their own world perspectives, which sort of unknowingly would be part of the algorithms as well. And not only the challenges, but what are the major opportunities with this approach, which might be beneficial for the overall teaching learning processes. So Sahana, would you like to go ahead first?
Okay, thanks. So this is a very important question, because it's there everywhere today. I just want to make two points. Both are based on what others have said. One is a talk I heard very recently by Professor Jayant Haritsa, who's a computer scientist in IISc. And a key takeaway for me from the talk, he also mentioned this, and you know, that's something which was important for me, was AI and ML should support the domain expertise. They should not lead it, nor should they be a substitute. Yes, there are some advantages. There are certain things that AI and ML can do. For example, maybe they can read our health scans, the radiation scans. They can pick up microscopic differences, which human eye can't do as fast. There are several other places where they have shown to be of value. However, they cannot, starting with the data first, without having the corresponding domain expertise, that can lead to a lot of hype, and they can lead to a lot of ugly things. So this was one point. The other thing which some of you may be familiar with is there is a course offered by the University of Washington called Calling Bullshit. And this has been going on for quite a few years. And in 2017 or 18, they call it Calling Bullshit in the AI and ML era. What they do is, their point is that, yeah, like you mentioned, Amit, there are these black boxes which make the decisions. They're very heavily statistically based. And not everybody can be expected to learn the statistical methods, nor should everybody be expected to do that, even though whatever, you know, these new agencies promise that we'll train you to be a data scientist in 3 months and all. None of that nonsense. But what they have done, and they show it through lots of case studies, is by training or by helping people learn how to sift through the inputs, input data for bias, for soundness. Let's have a syllabus to train our students, to help the adults figure out whether the input is sound, and at the same time to look at the output, the results, from a more critical eye, and let's help people figure out whether a quantitative claim is nonsense or not. And we can do it without having to go into technical details. The examples they show are actually quite accessible, and many of them are accessible in the sense it's not something that requires several years of statistical training. These are examples of published papers from Nature. There are definitely a lot of other newspaper examples. So one thing we have to be very, not just careful, we have to really promote strongly, given that AI and ML are there everywhere, is to help everybody learn how to sift what is nonsense, what is dangerous, and what is actually meaningful.
Thanks, Anna, for that input. So critical thinking is essential. I mean, no matter what the domain, to understand what is relevant or what is good and what is not good. So critical thinking ability is like one of the basic premises on which a lot of learning is based on. And hopefully some aspects of this might be relevant. Guru, would you like to pitch in some of your thoughts on this?
Yeah, actually, Amit, last January, IT for Change published a series of papers on AI in different sectors. So we looked at the logistics sector, we looked at fintech, finance sector, we looked at the agricultural sector, and one paper was on education. So the paper is titled Making AI Work for Indian Education. And in that, we have really discussed what are the possibilities and the pitfalls as far as AI is concerned in Indian for education. Indian education also is explored in some specifics. So I think one thing I want to say is that, you know, there's a guy called Kentaro Toyama who interestingly worked with Microsoft Research. So at that time, obviously, when he worked with Microsoft, he must have been very bullish about technology and education. We all know Microsoft is a very big player in this area. But subsequently, he wrote a very, very interesting article, which is titled, There Are No Technology Shortcuts to Good Education. And he says in that paper that every now and then, we have a cycle of a new technology coming in. And when the new technology comes in, you know, it's not anything to do with digital also. It has to do with when TV came, we know that, you know, people said TV is going to change the face of education in India and all over the world. And Hum Log as a series, you know, I'm old enough to belong to an era where Hum Log was a television serial, which people seriously believed would alter education in the country. And he says every now and then the hype comes, and after the hype, there is disillusionment. And this cycle keeps repeating because technologies keep changing. And AI clearly as one of them, where the amount of hype that we see today, it's, you know, it's mind-boggling. And the hype of AI is, in single phrase, is personalized learning. So personalized learning is supposed to completely revolutionize teaching learning. And, you know, all the failures of education are supposed to be rectified by personalized learning. These are some 2-3 very serious issues. You already mentioned one, Sahana also mentioned one, that there is already, whenever we talk about AI, there is bias. And simply because there is no, algorithm doesn't start from zero. Algorithm starts from decisions and paths that are laid out by the experts who are designing the AI in the first place. And their biases can greatly be harmful. And in that paper that we published last January, I've highlighted that India has a very serious problem in terms of reproduction of biases, because we are a feudal society. Much more than most societies, India is unique for the caste system, where every human being is superior or inferior to another human being simply because he was born in a particular family. And the idea of using the past to predict the future, the sense of AI, the sense of machine learning, the sense of algorithm is, can we look at the past and can we use the past to predict the future, is simply replication of the caste system. We are already seeing it happen in schools without AI. For example, I'm told in Delhi government schools, children as young as in the third standard are, you know, classified. This child is going to learn mathematics, put him in one section. This child is not going to be able to learn maths, put this child in another section, in class 3. And when I'm saying that, I'm sure you can appreciate that there's a huge problem here, because we know that it is the children of the marginalized groups, the Dalit children, the Adivasi children, the children of the poor, who will be the children who will be identified as not good for maths and therefore good for vocational occupations. In India, vocational means a blue collar job, unorganized sector, low wages, poor quality of life. So AI is going to be able to do that very well, because AI will clearly judge that the child of a plumber is good for plumbing, the child of a bureaucrat is good for liberal education. And that is what is the manifestation of, in some other space we say bias. In education, we can clearly see that it will create a problem. Niti Aayog is already saying, let's use AI to decide who is good for vocational education. Niti Aayog is already saying that. So that is a danger that we highlighted in the paper, that bias is lethal in AI, and that is one thing. Second thing, this whole idea of personalized learning, there's a very wonderful article written by a couple of authors, Van Dyck, if I'm getting the pronunciation right, I can share the link in the chat also. They say that the whole idea of technologification of teaching learning is creating a process called learnification. Learnification is atomizing a concept into narrower and narrower and narrower slices, because that's how technology can deal with it very well. So you go from number system to, you know, two-digit numbers, to addition of two-digit numbers, addition without carryover. So you make it more and more thin sliced, and then you create learning paths for children, and you imagine that the child learns concepts of number systems by simply doing smaller and smaller slices of learning materials, experiences with learning materials. And that, people say, is not really the way children learn. Children learning is not in that atomized way. It has to be collaborative, it has to be social, and conceptual understanding is not so mechanical a process. And these are the dangers that are going to come with AI. And I think in the next few years, we're going to see a lot of hype, and the government is also pushing it in a big way. I'm told recently that there is a huge DST funding for a lab at IIC Bangalore for setting up personalized learning models using AI. So it's already, you know, some few hundred crores have been pumped into this entity. So we are going to see that AI is going to create these kind of challenges. And of course, commercial pressures, which are the original one. We heard of Google and Baidu's coming together recently. So they are going to push their personalized learning models as the best thing that has happened in the education space. I can see a lot of danger, but what is a good possibility for AI? I would simply say, can we use AI to help the teacher figure out what are the different combinations, possibilities of bringing materials and methods together for constructing learner-centric contextual learning paths? So the teacher is driving that process, and Sahana said that also. I agree with her. If the teacher can be at the center of the process, then there is a possibility AI can do good. But if AI is used to displace a teacher, we are going to see increased stratification, reduced social mobility of education. That's the problem that I see. Sorry for a long answer.
Thanks, Guru. That was great to hear from you. Jian, would you like to pitch in for this?
I would make it very brief, since I think we're also running out of time, I suppose. So, a lot of it has already been said, I don't want to touch upon that, but I want to touch upon another important thing. There is a lesson from that we need to learn from these new terms that are being used called AI and machine learning and all that. One of the important lessons that we have is that how do machines learn? So they give two important aspects to that. One is give the machine a lot of experience, a lot of data. Okay. Two, give the machine a feedback. Okay. Because feedback is given in the form of, you know, adding weights and deleting weights and things like that, so that the learning happens in the proper direction. Now, this is something that is part of cognitive science as well. I mean, this is one of the important lessons. Now, my question to all of us is that there exists, such machines already in the world, and they're called human beings. And they already have all those algorithms. They only need two things. One, experience and feedback. So you give experience and feedback to all of us, and then we really don't need any of these other things. So we need sophistication in terms of how do we provide that experience. So if you want to use AI to provide that experience, if you want to provide AIR, whatever technology, you know, it could be a teacher, it could be another human being, another sophisticated colleague of mine or a friend of mine who will give me the feedback, then, you know, my learning and my experiences will be directed towards a particular side. So I would say, I would just simply say this following thing, that give a lot of experience to the child or to the learner, and provide feedback, both positive and negative feedback. Then we have 1.3 billion machines already in place. We don't need any more machines in this place. And I mean, I just want to call that as a natural intelligence. I mean, we of course use the pun of the artificial intelligence that is already there. So let us promote NI with or without machines.
Thanks, Jen. That answer. That's an interesting analogy that you made. So here, I mean, I would like to ask all of you one question, which is a recent development, very recent development in China. So recently, China actually made this as a policy that edtech companies cannot be for profit. So they sort of in one stroke overnight, like cut down on all the edtech companies that are in place in China, and some of the edtech companies were quite highly valued in terms of their stock. So do you think, I mean, something like this should be done in India as well? I would like to take your opinion on this aspect, that should edtech be only for not-for-profit, and for-profit edtech should not be allowed in following some sort of Chinese model in this?
I would include health also in that bracket, whether it is health technology or education technology. I think health and education for all can be done only if we reduce the commercial interests as much as possible. So we need a strong regulation certainly in that space.
Sahana and Guru, would you like to answer this question?
Yeah, so I think my response might be somewhat slightly different. It's again not a very easy response, but I do agree that education and health belong in one group, one sector, which is different from, say, telecom, or different from other sectors where commerce has actually is quite, it plays quite an important role. So rather than, I don't think I want to, be very strong on one side or the other, because I'm not very clear on it myself. Definitely not as strong as what GN is saying. But on the other hand, what I want to point out is, like, we all know the pitfalls, the problems, the serious danger of, since this has already been named, companies like Baiju's getting Shah Rukh Khan and IPLs and all. At the same time, there are commercial products. There is a company which it has its $100 product, it has a $10 product, and it has a 10 cent product, as they were saying. This is an Indian company. They were making a pitch to somebody from abroad. It was an international group. What they are doing is in their lowest cost product, they're using WhatsApp, which a certain large fraction of the country has. Again, it's not complete ubiquitous access, but a large fraction of the students have WhatsApp, have some phone which has WhatsApp, and they're using that to for not just delivery of content, but they're also getting the teachers involved, helping the teachers facilitate activities through that. It is commercial. There is a company involved. There is a cost involved, but it is at that level. I'm not promoting that company. That's why I don't want to name it now. But it is, there can be models where the commercial entities also have a role, and how to do it is a very difficult job. Regulations are clearly required, but there is a possibility for that. And I think it's worthwhile thinking along those lines in addition to just strong regulations, because in so many other sectors, it's just not been possible to say that we'll make it completely private. This is India. I mean, we are not China. And how to how to get all these different entities on board towards the same larger goal.
Yeah. Thanks, Sahana, for that different perspective. Guru, please go ahead.
Yeah. See, I think, Sahana, really what we need to look at is what is education's purpose? I think if we have a common understanding of what is education for example, you're sitting in IIT, and we know that the IIT cannot be a market phenomena. IIT can only work if a very significant large part of the higher education budget of the government of India is put in the IITs. I'm sure you'll agree with that. If the market were led to create IITs, we'll have a Jindal law school where a student has to pay lakhs to get admitted, and IITs will only be for the rich people of this country, right? So we must understand that education is very different from, you know, buying or selling shampoo, where you can have a 10 rupee shampoo, you can have a 1,000 rupee shampoo, you can have a 10,000 rupee shampoo, doesn't matter. Whatever you can afford, you can buy. But education is not a market good. I think this is what we need to really understand, that the purpose of education is, it is a process of social mobility. It is the only way by which a Dalit child, an Adivasi child, a Muslim child, a girl child across the country can hope to be able to visualize a life of dignity as much as a upper caste. Everybody in this panel, the three of us, we are upper caste, we are upper class. I mean, GN and I are also men. So we know that we are all extremely privileged people, and our privileges has allowed us to come to the places that we are sitting in, whether it's an IIT or IIT for Change or Homi Baba Center. Caste, class, religion, privileges are what have allowed us to come here. And if we allow the market to come in and play any role, this will only continue. So only rich people will have a right to education. Why should somebody get a 10-cent product? Does it occur to you to ask that question, that when you say 10-cent product and a $10 product, in your mind, it is already very clear that the poor child will get a 10-cent product, which is inferior to a $10 product, and will continue a life of poverty, marginalization, and lack of dignity. Whereas the parent who is able to afford a $10 product for his or her child, that child will go up in life. Education is the essential process of mobility for all of us as children. And if you're able to accept a 10-cent and a $10 product in education, I think there's a very serious problem here. And I think every child deserves a $10. Why should a child deserve a 10 cent? Because the parents can't afford it.
Two differences here, okay? One is, we're just talking of some... I agree with you when you say education as a large concept, okay? We're not saying that these companies are going to come and take over education entirely. We are talking of some...
Play. No, the minute, even if you give them... Sahana, please understand. Even if you give them a 5% space, you're accepting inequality. And the sense of education is not... Education cannot aim at inequality. It has to aim for equality. It has to aim for
equity. I don't
think
we are debating that at all.
Then there is no question for a commercial space, because commerce means stratification. See, if you look at a non-market good and a market good, by definition, a market good has to be 10 rupee tea for somebody, 100 rupee tea for somebody else, 1,000 rupee tea for somebody else. And tea is okay. You can drink a 10 rupee tea and not die. But the minute you say a 10 cent product, you're clearly saying poor people will continue to remain poor because they will be in poor education. And
actually,
I want to challenge,
yeah.
One second, let me finish. I want to challenge this thinking that China can do it, India can't do it. India can send a person to the Mars. India can build nuclear submarines, but India cannot make sure that our children get decent education. So I think our own preferences of policy, what is convenient for us, of course, we can build nuclear submarines, we can buy nuclear submarines, we can buy Rafale aircraft, but education, and people have done, economists have estimated the cost of good education system. It is not rocket, it is not the cost of rocket science, it is not the cost of sending people to Mars. Certainly we can afford good quality education. The minute we allow commercialization, we go away from any possibility that we can have equitable education for all. They are completely, I would say, binaries. We need to understand and appreciate that. What is politically doable is a political question. So that's what I would like to say. Go ahead.
So in your tea example, no, I'm actually making a much smaller point. I think in terms of the larger point and all, I don't see myself disagreeing with you. There is a much smaller point I'm making. Taking your tea analogy, the difference between a 10 rupee tea and a 100 rupee tea is often in the frills, you know, the kind of chair I sit in, the room, whether I'm sitting in Taj or in Badlu Cafe in next to my department and all. But there is an issue of the quality of the taste of tea. I won't even use the word quality, the taste of tea. Now, I can get really rubbish tea in Taj. I can get excellent tasty tea in Badloo. But the cost difference is that of everything else that's coming around. So the point I was trying to make is that when companies are there, what we don't want to withhold from people is this taste of tea. Somebody has, you know, wants to go and sit in Taj. A lot of people might know that, yeah, I'm just paying for the frills. We are not talking, there is inequality, yes, not, you know, saying that there is no inequality there. But it's actually the taste, which is, that's the only point I was trying to make here. Agreed that tea is... So,
taste has nothing to do with the market. That's all I'm saying. You can have any number of tastes. Let there be 1,000 tastes. But it's not a market good, Sahana. I think you can do some reading on public goods and market goods. I think then we will get a... In India, it's illegal. By the way, Sahana, let me tell you and everybody else in this call, in India, for-profit education is illegal. What Google and Baijus are doing is illegal. Somebody can go to court. There's already a Supreme Court judgment which says, Unnikrishnan judgment which says, education cannot be for-profit in India. Of course, we know that there are, people exploit loopholes and all. But tea and education are different, Sahana. That's what we need to understand.
Agree. So why are we debating the lack, you know, the existence of private schools now?
Schools are not for profit. They're supposed to be not for profit. So commercial, we are not against private. I'm not against private. And GN is not against private. We are against commercial. There's a difference between private initiative, which is not for profit, and commercial. So there are a lot of differences we need to be very clear about. I work in a private agency, which is IT for Change, an NGO, but I'm a not-for-profit. Not-for-profits can set up schools. A not-for-profit will not have a 10-cent product and a 100-cent product. It's against the basic ethics of education.
I don't know if we still have time. Can I chip in with a very short
Quickly, Jian. Last.
So very quickly, I would like to say this point, which has not been directly touched upon, and that is why I want to touch upon this subject, is the point that if the government doesn't have any responsibility of this kind and say that, you know, education should be priced, then one immediate thing that they have to do is they have to stop taking taxes, first of all. Because why are we giving taxes to the government? And why do we have to do double and triple and treble taxation at every point? If I'm already paying for my mobile or the device, I'm already paying for the bandwidth, again, I have to pay for the content is unjustifiable for every step of the way. And this is, I think, a very wrong economic model for a democratic, distributable justice that our constitution is seeking for. And equity in this case has to be taught. And this is our right to get equal education for all. And we are already paying taxes for that. And therefore, we have every right to make sure that education has to be public. And it is already been paid for. And so we are not demanding anything extra from it. And then passing on this responsibility and encouraging all the private agencies which are profit-oriented are essentially a way of asking citizens to pay one more tax on that very subject for which the government has already collected tax from everybody.
Thanks, Jen. I think we had a very interesting discussion going just now. I think the last thing that we had of last mile connectivity, we have touched upon it several times in the previous discussion. So I think I'll pass it on and we'll take some questions from the audience regarding this. I think to all the panelists, the hosts, the organizers have shared with you a document which has a sort of text of all the questions that have been asked in the chat. So, and some of them have been also answered by you there. So is there any question that perhaps you would like to expand upon? So I can read out the questions in the chat, or I can share my screen so that we have those questions visible. So how would you like to go about it? I mean, there are some questions directed at particular speaker and some of the questions are of more general nature. So maybe we can start with some questions directed towards a particular panelist. So I think the first question is by Deepika. She says that, what are the environmental impacts of using new technology and media extensively? Should we take them into account to have a balanced view on tech and education? So anybody can respond to the general question. Hello. Sahana, Guru, Jian, I mean, would anyone of you like to respond to this question?
I just started looking at most of those questions, so I actually could not listen to you. Can you repeat with the question that you're asking?
Yeah, the question is about environmental impact of all the electronic products that we'll be generating.
I actually sort of responded to that in the chat, mm-hmm. Saying that, whether it is this technology or that technology, I think environmental audit is very important. And I also think that that is one of the reasons why, we want to create, instead of creating personal machines, we need to have shared machines. You know, we can't say no to computers, that's a different thing. But what we can certainly do is to create community interfaces so that, people can access machines. And they can log into their own personal spaces once they're in the machine. But the machine itself should be made in a shareable manner rather than the way how we are doing it, because we know very well that information technology, whether it's the hardware, most of the time it is the hardware, and also the machines that run actually consume enormous amount of electricity and the carbon footprint and all that we heard from them. And it does enormous amount of damage to the environment. And I certainly think that we should mitigate that damage as we move on. And my answer to that is, let's make our resources shareable instead of increasing the need of how many devices a person needs.
Yeah, thanks, Jian, for that. So Ayush then continue. Yeah, please go ahead, Guru.
Quickly add to what Jian was saying, everything should be shareable, not only the hardware, but the software, the content, and that's the whole free and open digital technology space, that whatever is that is shareable, and that thereby we reduce the footprint. I think the other thing I want to add is, there is a clear problem about the political and the technological in today's world. And there are, we assume that technology will run in its own space and we are simply following it, but that's not true. Every society makes choices about the direction in which society should go. So if Google is powerful today, Amazon is powerful today, it is because today's legal frameworks, political frameworks allow that. So even in the case of environment, it's not that technology is running apace and environment is in danger. That's also a conscious choice that we are making. And therefore, my thinking is that, how can the political come back and control the technological? How can the political come back and control the economic so that education concerns and environmental concerns are both taken care of? And in France, I'm told there was a proposal many years back to say you should not be allowed to send emails after 5 o'clock. So what is the kind of life that we want to live economically, philosophically, and how can we use policy to regulate that to the extent that we are able to prevent economic interest from creating problems for the environment? I'm just saying political has to come back and play a key role. By political, I don't mean politicians, I mean our collective will.
Okay, thanks, Guru. Sahana, would you like to add to this question of aspect of environment of technological devices?
Let's go ahead.
Amit, you're on mute.
Amit, you're on mute.
Yeah, thanks. I changed the tabs. I thought I was still speaking. So Ayush adds to this question on, I think this has been covered a bit on what has been talked about. He says that how should we think about the human aspect of production of technology, especially in poor and marginalized community in low middle income countries. So I think some aspects of it we have already covered. Then Asmita asked one question particularly to Sahana, and I think this is about your part of the first theme that we had. So she asked that should there be some standardization of cost of product as well? I think this was regarding some of the things, I think that platform that you had shown to us. So this is in context of that platform. Sahana, would you like to respond?
Yeah, so I'll just quickly respond to this because there was a lot of debate on this earlier. And this is related to one of the much later questions that Aniket mentioned about the $100 product. So I have seen both the products, okay, the $100 and the 10 cent product. And the difference is actually in, there is a difference, yes. The difference is in terms of the frills. In terms of the experience, whether, you know, for students and teachers, because we sort of just, we haven't done a formal study, but we just sort of got some data. In terms of the experience, there was no significant difference. There is, however, a big difference in the packaging. So that I just wanted to put this out. I'm not advocating for the $100 product, but the way it had been constructed was, what is the difference is not in some of the core aspects.
And we are allowing people to be fooled by packaging, no? Is that what we want education to be? Some packaging that will fool people?
It's not about fooling people, but some people, are you saying that we should just not have any?
You can't have stratification. The whole idea of education is not money making. See, people, a teacher gets a salary.
So
the minute you have stratification, you're getting to unethical ground. That's what I want to really caution you. It's unethical to provide stratification.
Yeah, I think, go ahead, Asmita, if you want to add to that.
Yeah. So, Sahana, this was asked before this subsequent discussion took place, when you said that the content has to be standardized. So I just added if the cost, and then we had extensive discussion. So I agree with your point, what you are saying now. But I would like to add Guru in this case, that he made a statement that in India, as China has put forth a step towards making education a free resource, India already has that in place. But then what do you say about private coaching classes? And almost even a Dalit, I've seen even a Dalit trying to put her child in private coaching out of the fear that she wouldn't get enough in the school and schools were closed. The other thing that I have recently learned is for last 4 to 5, or rather a few more years, teacher recruitment has stopped at this is school level. In some districts of eastern Maharashtra, I can say for sure, which I have been visiting. So while we are talking about, you know, teacher being an agency, while technology has its place, what if the teacher doesn't exist? And the third point would be, what when the government itself is making freeway for private players? So if it is illegal, how can we stop this happening? So like Byju's taking over schools which have no teachers recruited in them. So how would you put this? So all those hopeful anticipations of equality are good, but the reality is there. And if the law isn't, the law still says it's illegal, why, what is stopping us from stopping them go ahead with it on the freeway? Yeah, that's my question. Over to you.
Please, Guru and Sahana, both you can respond.
Yeah. So I think, see, what Asmita is saying is it's a very complex reality. So we need to be able to distinguish our arguments in two ways. And we need to do both at the same time. One is we have to see what is the reality that we are in. We are in a reality that the governments are not willing to invest in education. We are in a reality that governments are not interested in empowering teachers. We are in a reality that government is not interested in the mobility of the marginalized groups. This is real. And it's not only government. I think society itself, our political will that every child should get the same quality of education, it's not there. as I said earlier, India is a caste system, and the, you know, the upper caste person is not going to like it if his driver's children are going to the same school that his children are going. That is a real, that's a reality of today. And that, and the reality is also that the Dalits and the marginalized groups are also desperate because they know that the government school is not giving them what they should get, and therefore they are going into tuitions. And the sad thing is, you know, in rich families, the child may go to tuition in class 8. In poor families, I've seen children are going to tuition from class 1 because the faith in the government system or the faith in the regular school is very low. So this is a reality. We need to understand that. We need to resist it. We need to see what we can do about it. But independent of the reality, there is also a purpose of education. So the purpose of education is not to create inequity, create inequality, create stratification. The purpose of education is a new society in which there is equality, there is equity, there is justice, there is democracy. Education itself is a process of moving from one to the other, moving from inequity and stratification to equality and equity. But the fact is, while education is supposed to be that process of transcending inequality, education itself becomes subject to inequality. So this is a complex reality we are living in. We need to be able to do both. We need to be able to, at the normative level, clearly argue that something like Baijus is wrong. Coaching classes are wrong because, if again, it depends on what is the purpose of the coaching class. The coaching class is really working on progressive educational processes and not in a, you know, trying to say your child will become better than my child. Then coaching by itself may not be a problem if it is conforming to the educational principles, philosophies, processes of an equitable democratic society. But we know that mostly coaching classes are not like that. Coaching classes are simply to give a competitive edge or to fulfill a gap left behind by the main school system. So while we look at realities, education is not about replicating those realities. So we cannot argue coaching classes are there, therefore 5 cent and $10 technology products are okay. No, coaching class is wrong. Technology products are also wrong. So we need to be able to argue at the level of principle and say, this is wrong, this is right. At the same time, we also look at the realities and say, how collectively we can get all of us together to resist that reality and bring forth a new reality. That has happened. You know, I'm sure when Sati was being practiced, several people would have said, Sati is being practiced. What can we do about it? Let us burn more women at the pyre. But Rajaram Mohan Roy said, it cannot be done. We have to protest against this. We have to change the policy framework. So China also did not make it illegal suddenly, right? They also would have seen a lot of challenges with coaching classes, with the way tech companies are going about it. And they said, we will change the policy framework. In a communist country, it may be easier. In a democratic situation like India, it will be much more difficult. I don't have any illusions of that. But we have to be asking ourselves, what is it that we want to do? We are working in education. As a person working in education, do you want to increase that stratification or do you want to counter stratification? And like Kishore said in the chat, why are we imagining that equity and quality are two different things? That equity, you know, promotion is different, but, you know, stratification can still happen because quality is satisfied by that. Quality, equity go together. So we have to be clear about the normative space that education is. We have to be clear what we will promote, what we will oppose, but accept that the reality is not what we want it to be. But education is a process of transcending that reality. Let us understand that.
Yeah, thanks, Guru, for that. Sahana, would you like to pitch in one last thing for this point?
No, I think Guru has said it very eloquently. Let's go to, okay. I mean, if we are still continuing, there are many questions.
I think we have almost run out of time now. But we had very interesting discussion on all the themes that we could cover. And we did not cover one thing explicitly, but I think it was implicitly covered in many of the discussions that we had about accessibility. And I'll thank you very much for all the panelists and also the participants via their questions, making it very rich experience to debate on these crucial issues that we face as going forward with technology being a major player in what we do in all aspects of our life, and education is no different to that. So I'd like to thank for the organizers also for having me here as well as the panelists. So over to the organizers. If you have to say something, please go ahead. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you, Amit. Thank you all the panelists for joining. And thank you audience for coming with lots of deep questions. And Yeah, so we will be joining at 2 o'clock. Okay, thank you.